Welcome back to Purgatorio, the 13th century poem written by Dante Alighieri. In the last episode, Dante and Virgil met the indolent and unshriven in anti-purgatory, late repentance awaiting passage to purgatory proper. Afterwards they found Sordello, who agreed to provide them guidance for a while. In this episode, we'll continue to follow their path through the Valley of Rulers, up to the adamant gate of purgatory. First of all, let's talk about our newest traveller, Sordello. Sordello was an Italian that lived just one or two generations before Dante, around 1180 to 1269. Sordello was from Mantua, like Virgil, and spent his days wandering Europe as a composer and performer of poetry. Specifically, Sordello was a troubadour, a performer of lyric poetry in a language called Old Occitan, which was not his native tongue. Sordello is perhaps most recognisable for his very open opinions on the rulers of his day. His work, The Plain, or The Lament, is a masterpiece in which he boldly expresses his opinions on their deficiencies. Around 1245, Sordello found himself staying at the residence of a married countess named Beatrice, to whom he reportedly wrote all of his succeeding love poems for. In later life, Sordello reluctantly entered military service on the side of the Guelphs, where he fought battles against the Ghibellines. You'd be correct in thinking that the story of Sordello sounds eerily similar to a description of Dante, an Italian who writes invectives against those in power, with an undying love for a woman named Beatrice. A world-weary man who fights for the Guelphs and writes controversial poetry in an unorthodox language. All of this is, perhaps, not accidental, as Dante was certainly very aware of Sordello when writing Purgatorio. In Dante's Devulgari Eloquentia, or On Elegance in the Vernacular, a work he wrote before his comedy, he actually mentions Sordello by name. Our poet praises Sordello for substituting his native tongue, calling him a man of unusual eloquence. In this next episode, pay close attention to the way that Sordello acts towards those with power, as it is also evidence that Dante was intimately aware of what made Sordello so famous. With the day coming to an end, the three poets consider where best to make camp for the night. Sordello mentions a pleasant place that he knows, and offers to lead them there. Dante asks why it is that they cannot continue climbing. Is there some rule which prevents this at night? Sordello walks upwards a few meters, bends down to the floor, and draws a line in the soil. Looking at Dante, he replies that he doubts they could even reach this marker at night. There is no physical or spiritual obstacle stopping them from trying, but without the light of the sun, their will to climb shall escape them.
Is it true that one might go down again and wander about the mountain while the night is here?
Virgil interrupts and instructs Sordello to lead them to the pleasant place that he mentioned before. With that abruptness, Sordello sets off and the two poets follow behind him. Only a short time passes before Dante spots a harsh dip in the hill ahead. The dip gets steeper and steeper and eventually becomes a deep valley. Sordello says that the base of this valley is their destination. He guides Virgil and Dante to a more gradual, albeit crooked, path downwards. The valley is a wondrous sight of colour. Dante proclaims that gold, silver, polished wood, indigo, and even emerald would be outshone by the vibrancy here. The air is thick, with thousands upon thousands of different sweet odours, combining to form their own unknowable scent. On the downward path, Dante sees a small band of souls singing Salve Regina at the bottom.
Before what little sun there is takes its rest, you'll easily be acquainted with all their faces and actions in this terrace.
This place is the Valley of Rulers, the negligent kings and princes who repented genuinely but late. Some of the penitents here cared more for their subjects than their own souls, Some cared more for their own souls than their subjects. God demands both, and in this, these rulers are deficient. Sordello spends the next while speaking of various rulers and their deficiencies. He first describes Emperor Rudolf, sat on the highest seat and not singing with the rest. This man neglected his duty to heal the wounds of Italy, making his successor's inherited problems more dangerous for the country. Rudolf is comforted by his in-life political rival, Ottokar II of Bohemia. Sordello next speaks of a snub-nosed soul. This one, the poet says, is the father to the pestilence of France. History tells us that Sordello is speaking of Philip III of France, and the pestilence, his son, Philip IV. Henry I of Navarre sits beside Philip III. He is a kind-faced man, but he is also stepfather to this same pestilence. The father and stepfather are described to be transfixed with grief. The next two souls that Sordello describes are the one with the aquiline nose, Charles I of Anjou, and Peter III of Aragon. Charles and Peter are singing together in unison. Sordello says that if the young man seated behind Peter, his eldest son Alfonso III, succeeded him, that Peter's good rule would have been inherited by that son. In history, Peter broke up his kingdom amongst his three eldest sons, Alfonso III, Frederick III, and James II. Sordello's attacks against Peter's other sons is fairly radical for the time, and is an attempt by Dante to illustrate his theory that nobility is not usually inherited. Sordello continues that the successor to the singing Charles I is also unfit to rule.
So far was the sea degenerate that Constantia had more reason to boast of her husband than Beatrice and Margarita of theirs.
Other kingly souls in the valley include Henry III of England, relaxing nonchalantly. Sordello says that Henry was quite fortunate with the quality of his own heirs. Finally, at the lowest level sits Marquis William VII, who caused the wars against Alessandria, which still makes Montferrat and the Canaves weep.
It was by now the hour that turns to home, the longing thoughts of seafarers, melting hearts the day they said goodbye to dearest friends. And when by love the pilgrim, new to this, is pierced to hear far off the evening bell that seems to mourn the dying of the day.
Just taking a quick aside regarding that last, fairly beautiful quote from Dante. It speaks simply of this. Dante is like a traveler in the night, looking back at home nostalgic for his loved ones and the wonderful light of day. This quote is also special in that it is memorialized to this day at Dante's own grave in Ravenna, notably in sound. Every day, representing that far-off evening bell, the chapel bell tower beside his tomb, a gift from the municipalities of Italy, rings 13 times. Dante speaks of one of the souls raising his arms into the air. The penitent's hands are pressed together in a content, prayer-like pose. This negligent ruler recites Talutis ante terminum, or to thee before the close of day. In harmony, the rest of the group begin this same ritual, fixating their eyes to the celestial spheres above. They are waiting for something. Suddenly, from the sky, descends two magnificent green angels, each carrying tipless burning swords. Their green robes are vibrant and flutter under the low gust of their green wings. One lands on the other side of the valley, and the other just above our poets, leaving the negligent rulers right between them in the middle. Dante looks to see their fair hair and faces, and is completely stunned and dazzled by them. Sordello explains that these angels have arrived from Mary herself, sent to guard this valley from the serpent which will imminently arrive.
Now, let us go down amongst those great shadows and talk with them. You will be very welcome among them.
It only takes a few steps before Dante discovers one of the penitent royalty steering back in his direction. It's dark, but not completely. Dante can still see things between himself and this soul. With a few more steps, he realizes that the penitent is Nino Visconti, judge or king of Galura. Dante welcomes that it was pleasant not to see Nino suffering in hell. The soul greets Dante and asks how long it has been since Dante came to Purgatory. How long since he traveled the great waters to reach this island?
I came this morning from the place of sorrow, and I am still alive. By my journey, I will gain another life.
This is the first time Sordello has heard of Dante's journey through hell. Both he and Nino take a step back, astonished. Another soul turns to look at Virgil, and Nino hastens others to witness Dante.
Up, Conan. Come and see what God by his grace has willed.
Nino asks Dante to tell his daughter Giovanna to pray for him. His widow, Giovanna's mother, no longer mourns for him because she has taken it upon herself to remarry. Nino scorns women in particular, saying that they have a love that ends too early if it is not constantly rekindled. He comments that the Milanese viper, which will now adorn her burial, will not be as fine a display as if it was his family's Galuran rooster. Dante notes that Nino is straight-faced through this whole exchange, presenting his measured resolve in this matter. Dante looks up to the sky, peering at the slowest stars right at the pole. Virgil inquires what Dante is looking at, and our poet replies three stars in particular, three bright, torch-like stars, bright enough to light up the whole southern sky.
The four bright stars which you saw this morning are low, and these stars have risen now to take their place.
Sordello interrupts and directs the attention of the other poets, pointing at something obscure in the distance.
Behold, there is our adversary.
Before them now appears a snake, slithering amongst the flowers and the grass. Dante wonders if this could be the same which tempted Eve with bitter fruit so long ago. The snake cleans itself from time to time, licking its own back and turning its head to and fro. Our poet describes that with the sighting, the angels drop down and split the air with their green wings. He explains that he doesn't understand how they were able to do it, because he couldn't see them do it. The snake flees from the heavenly warriors, the angels having performed the role they should have performed with Adam and Eve. Conrad, the soul that Nino called over a while ago, has been staring at Dante this entire time. He wishes well for Dante's travels, hoping the poet finds as much wax in his will as possible to light the way to heaven's summit. Conrad asks for news of Valdemagra and its surrounding areas, identifying himself as Conrad Malaspina the Younger. Dante admits that he has never visited the lands Conrad speaks of, but notes the especially courteous nature of the Malaspina family, and how famous it has made the lands they rule, not just in Italy, but all of Europe. He tells Conrad that his family is singularly defiant against the sinners who twist the world.
And I swear to you, as I would reach the summit, that your family is still honored and has lost nothing in generosity or in valor.
Using the constellations, Conrad predicts that it will not be another 7 years before Dante finds the hearsay rumors of the Malaspina family to be true.
Seven before the courteous opinion you have uttered shall be nailed in the middle of your head, with bigger nails than the words of men.
Conrad's inclusion here is another subtle nod to Dante's theories about inherited nobility. Also, Conrad's family, Malaspina, were a family who hosted Dante during his exile. Night has fully fallen over the group. Our poet, still flesh and blood, is finally taken by sleep. He rests in the grass for many hours, and as the approach of dawn comes, he begins to dream. He has visions of an eagle with golden feathers, ready to plunge from lofty heights. He imagines himself on Mount Ida, where Jupiter kidnapped Ganymede in the form of an eagle. He wonders if the eagle only draws up its prey from this one place, ignoring all other places. The eagle strikes at him, swooping down to clutch him and carry him upwards to the fiery sun. Dante feels great pain as he burns in this dream. The searing agony strikes him back to consciousness. Dante wakes up in confusion, comparing himself to Achilles, who awoke shaken in Skiro after being kidnapped by his mother. The poet is pale and visibly unsettled from his dream. He is no longer with the group of rulers or Sordello, and he has moved a significant distance since he fell asleep. Around him, he is now once more only comforted by the presence of Virgil.
Have no fear, we are in the right place. Pull all your strength, for you now have arrived at Purgatory. See there the ridge that encloses it, and see there the gate which we must now enter.
That's it for episode 3. What did you think? Let us know in the comments. If you're new to us here at Aspect History, why not check out one of our other videos linked right here? As always, I've been Circle Strafe, and I'll see you in the next episode. Toodles!